In our study, we began at chapter 11 of this wonderful book, Hosea, and we have moved from chapter 11 through 14, and the major emphasis of the study has to deal with looking at what it is that God says directly from his own mouth about how he loves us, and what it is that he points out and what it is he sees and gives to us in terms of encouragement in relationship to his love for us. And as I've said before, as you go through the Word of God, a lot of times what you find are passages like 1 Corinthians, what is the love chapter? Thank you, God. This slipped my mind totally. 1 Corinthians 13. Yes, that's right. That's right. That's welcome to the class. In that chapter, it's a description of God's love. It's the best known chapter in the Bible that has to do with what love is and the actions of love. But again, it's not really God himself explaining to us what love is. And so what we find in these particular chapters is the voice of God explaining over and over and over his feelings and his emotions and his motives and his actions as to what it is that he feels about us, the people of God, the people who have walked with him but also fallen away. And so this is a description that we have. Beginning in chapter 14, which is, of course, the end of this book, we have a real strong plea from God in verse 1 to return, to the relationship with God that he had designed and wanted from the very beginning. And he explains how to return, and we've already looked at verses 1 through 3 and kind of broke those up to where we would understand God's explaining to you and me what's the essence of returning. Okay. What is the essence of returning? So we've looked at those three verses, and again, we don't want to spend a lot of time going back over those, okay, in relationship to our study this morning. Then, after that is explained in verses 1 through 3, what you have beginning in verse 4 through 7 is after you return, there is a response by God in relationship to the return. Okay. So if you turn around and you express inside of your own heart your desire to repent and turn completely around, okay, and head in another direction, God will respond to that. And when he responds to it, what is he trying to do? Okay, what are the things that are in his mind when you respond to him in repentance and in the return? Okay, and so we've looked at that as well. We looked at verses 4 through 7 in relationship to that, and we spent a little time emphasizing the word do, okay, in that response and God explaining to you and me how he felt about that response. He basically used the figures of a plant needing a growth, okay, and that he would furnish that growth. And when that plant began to grow, he would cause dew to fall on that plant almost every day to give it this kind of refreshment, okay, that caused it to produce fruit. And then he described what that fruit looked like. And if you want to look down on your sheet that I've given to you in number 2 on the sheet towards the bottom, this is a list of what God says you will look like when you return and you're forgiven and your relationship with God is reestablished, that essentially you will be like these words. And it's a very, very beautiful description of what your life will become. It will be like you will blossom. He says that you will blossom under my care. Okay, you will take root under my care. You will have shoots that will sprout. You will be beautiful. You will be fragrant. You will live under the shadow of the Almighty. You will be renowned for your fruit. So when this return occurs and the reestablishment of a man's relationship with God, God is responding and saying, I will love you. I will heal you. I will take away your doubts and your apostasy. And after that has occurred, I will then cause you to be fruitful in your life. Okay, and this is the description of the fruit. Okay, not so much the product of the fruit, but the growth in your own life. Okay, that your life will blossom, that it'll be fragrant, that it'll put down deep roots, and that your life will actually give something to other people in such a way that your name will be known. Okay, and your name will be known that you're His. So that's a beautiful description. That's God saying that to you and me. Okay, that's not Hosea speaking, that's God speaking. Okay. And so it's a scripture that helps us understand God's sense inside of His own mind of what you and I are to become, but also what you will become. In other words, this is what He sees you as. Now, He uses this image all the time. In John chapter 15, Jesus uses it exactly the same concept. I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me will bring forth much fruit. Okay, except this one's a little bit more expansive in relationship to the image of the fruit, but the image within your own life. You know, it's nice for God to say to you, you will be a fragrance to people's lives. When people are around you, they'll see the beauty of you. Okay, when the people are around you, they will understand that you are giving them something that is from me. Okay, and your name will become renowned. Okay, and so it's a very, very beautiful image as to psychologists tell us that one of the two basic ideas about why a man searches for meaning, what is it he's searching for? He's searching for significance. Okay, he is searching that his life counts. Okay, and the world that he is around. And this is how God is explaining how you will count. Okay, and your life will be under his shadow. Now, all of that's explained in verses 4 through 7, which we've already taken time to go through. So what we want to look at is verse 8 and 9, the last two verses of this book. Okay? So let's take a look at that. O Ephraim, what more have I to do with idols? It is I who answered and looked after you. I am like a luxuriant cypress. From me comes your fruit. Whoever is wise, let him understand these things. Whoever is discerning, let him know them. For the ways of the Lord are right, and the righteous will walk in them, but transgressors will stumble in these words. Now, verse 8 is a bit troubling. In other words, in terms of translation, it does not fit in the way that it's translated in the way that I read it. And the NIV does the same thing. But if you listen to the discussion about this verse, it sounds as though verse 8 is the voice of God. Okay, that's what it sounds. But most translators said this does not fit in the way it's working its way through this passage. And there are words that are in the Hebrew that cause you to not sure if it's God's voice or if it's Ephraim's voice or both. Okay, and so Dallas Theological Seminary in their commentary takes it that this verse contains both Ephraim's response and God's response. The King James also does the same. Okay, other translators later on changed it and moved it in another direction. Okay, so I am taking it because I think it makes very, very good sense for the way that the King James has done it, as well as Dallas Theological Seminary, and looking at the verse and seeing that both voices are in this verse, not just God's. Okay, so what you're finding is 6 and 7, God is speaking, and now Ephraim responds. Okay, and then God responds to Ephraim. Okay, and that's the way they see it translated. All right. So I've got it there for you as we go through verse 8 at the top there. This verse is often seen in translation as Ephraim's final response in its return to the Lord. It is translated by the Bible Knowledge Commentary by Dallas Theological Seminary as Ephraim shall say, this is Ephraim speaking, Ephraim shall say, what have I to do anymore with idols? That makes this verse a lot clearer. Okay, it isn't God saying, what have I to do with idols anymore? Okay, it's basically saying that Ephraim is saying that. Ephraim is saying, what have I to do anymore with idols? It is I who answer. And now God speaks in when Ephraim says that. Okay, and so they have repented. They have come to the Lord. And God, they have returned. And God has responded to them in all these different verses as to that return. And then Ephraim responds again and basically says, what do I have to do anymore with idols in my life? And God says, if that is your attitude, if that is the true repentance of your heart, then essentially I myself will respond to you again. Okay? And that's what it's saying in relationship to that. Okay, it is I who will answer you, okay, when you speak in that manner. Okay, God responds to change in Ephraim. The what more of Ephraim implies a definite previous set of acts with idols, and the now new position of the attitude of repentance, the true return, God's response in 4 through 7, and now 8b, okay, we're in verse 8, in the second half, demonstrates the attitude of Ephraim is genuine. Okay, so when you return, when God speaks to you of your need of repentance, and you make that move, okay, then you have all these verses that come along, and then at the very end, Ephraim is saying, "I will not have any more to do with idols," and God says, if that's true, then this is the last response. Okay? So that's what you're seeing in this verse. All right. I wondered, first of all, in verse 8 on your outline there, it says, in the attitude of return by Ephraim is genuine, then it is I who respond. God is not silent to our repentance. He gives a word and answer and then moves in action to respond. But before we go to that, this concept that Ephraim had been tied to idols and now has decided not to be tied to idols and is giving himself 100% to God, and then God will respond to him. The question that again is raised, I've spoken twice on this passage, in the last 2 weeks, but there's been several weeks in between. The last time I did this, the message that was brought by Ron had to do with your repentance of sin. Okay? This time I'm bringing this, and basically the issue is, are you tied to idols or not? And of course, Carlin's message is about being tied to idols. That's exactly right. Yeah, that's right. We're tuned to the same source. And like I said, I've been doing this for 30 years, and I was for about a year in the pulpit itself, so I could see it happen in the other direction. When God really truly wants to speak to his people, he will speak. Our problem is we have to then respond. And this is exactly what this passage is about. It is the final plea of God, return. Okay? And then there is a description of repentance, of what that really looks like. Okay? And we elaborated on that when we went to Psalm 51, but Ron had already elaborated on it, and extensively, okay, as to what that repentance should look like. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a steadfast spirit. Okay? And so we went through all of that and looked at that week. And now we come to the issue is, Ephraim has said in his mouth, he has said, I will not place anything before God anymore. I will not have anything else to do with idols.